Section 2.7 part 2 is about the inverse of a function. An inverse of a function is another function which undoes what the original function did. That is, if our original function takes x to y, our inverse function takes y and maps it back to x. In order for this to work and for the result to actually be a function, it turns out that the original function must actually be 1 to 1, which is why it's in this section. So let f be a 1-to-1 function with domain A and range B. So everything it hits is in B. Then f inverse is denoted with f to the negative 1 power, has domain, it exists, and it has domain B, it flips these two around, and range A. And it's defined by basically what we just said, f inverse of y equals x if and only if f of x equals y. So every time we have an ordered pair, so this means f has ordered pairs that look like x, y's, and f inverse has ordered pairs that are the same terms but y, x's. Every one-to-one function has an inverse function, and it's unique. There's only one. If we have f and f inverse and they're inverses of one another, then if we take the composition of functions, do f of x first and then do f inverse, what should we get? Well, the inverse is supposed to undo what this one does, so we ought to get back to x. And the same goes if we compose in the other direction. So if you recall back when we were talking about composition of functions, I said there are some special functions which when we compose them in either direction, we get the same answer. And here's one of them. Any function which has an inverse, any one-to-one function, you compose it with its inverse either direction, and you get what you want. You know what? I'm going to change these. You get the same result. I'm going to change these to be y's, just to be clear about where these guys are. So these are in the range of the original function f, and these x's are in the domain of the original function. Example 3 asks us to show that f and g are inverses of one another. We're going to do this algebraically, but let's also talk through it just logically about what's happening here. In this one, I'm multiplying by 3 and then subtracting 7. How do I undo that? Well, the last operation I did was subtract 7. So this adds 7 and then divides by 3, so it undoes what that one did. Now let's show that algebraically. What we need to do is take the composition and show that we get x. So when I put g in first, then I'm going to plug that in for x here. So 3 times this quantity minus 7. Well, the multiplication by 3 cancels, and I'm left with x plus 7 minus 7. So those cancel, and I get x, and that's exactly what I'm supposed to get. And I'll leave it to you to check the other direction, but basically the same thing occurs. Now, graphically, we could find an inverse by using a reflection across the line y equals x from the original function. So that's swapping x's and y's. So we could also do it from a table. I just want to emphasize here we have algebraically, we talked about it in words, we could do it from a graph by a reflection, or we could do it from the table by just swapping the x and the y values. In example 4, we need to find an inverse. So f of x is x to the 5th power minus 3 over 2. So that idea of swapping x's and y's is exactly what we're going to do here. We're going to rewrite this as y equals x to the 5th minus 3 over 2. And now to find the inverse, we're going to swap. So we swap the x for a y in the y. Now we want to solve for y. So we'll multiply by 2. I'm going to keep going over here. Then I'm going to add 3. And lastly, I'm going to take the 5th root. So there is my inverse function. So f inverse is the 5th root of the quantity 2x plus 3. f was x to the fifth minus 3 over 2. Let's talk about each of these operations, make sure this makes sense. What does f do? It takes something to the fifth power, then subtracts 3, then divides by 2. We need to undo those in reverse order. So we multiply by 2 first, then we add 3, then we take the fifth root. So these inverses make sense with one another. You can always double check by taking f inverse of f of x, making sure you get x, and f of f inverse of x, and make sure you get x. So this is how you check if you're in doubt. And I think probably checking one of them is sufficient because you already did all the work to get there. You're going to find any errors probably in that first step. So it's probably sufficient to just check one of them. And that's all there is for this section.